I would like to welcome you all again and hope you all enjoy the snacks. I would like to introduce Professor R. Balasubramanian, PhD, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, and President of the Cryptology Research Society of India, Kolkata. He has been honored by various awards like the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize for Science and Technology, the Padma Shri, Fellow of the American Mathematical Society, Fellowship at Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi, the National Academy of Sciences, Allahabad. Professor will be giving a talk on elliptic curves and shifted sums.
Dear friends, I am rather happy to be here in participating in this workshop. I think this is the second time that I am coming, and the first time was a couple of years back or 2-3 years back, where I was, when I was here more or less for a similar workshop. Good. I had some PowerPoint presentation, and that, but then after talking to Manisha and some of the students who came to see me yesterday, I thought I would make this a change in the presentation, and therefore I would now make it as a blackboard presentation. But probably the title can remain the same, even though we'll be talking on different things. Okay, essentially, what does a number theory is to do? One thing is it is sort of counting various objects. And once you are not able to count properly, then you try to estimate. Then you count how many and see what is that order in which you would be there. And many of the times, then when you are counting, then things which are of a smaller magnitude, you tend to ignore. Therefore, you count, and then there is a main term as one calls in number theory, and then there is an error. And therefore, up to a certain error, you count something, which essentially would give you an idea of how many elements are there. And in fact, yeah, the title of my talk, or even the abstract, essentially says that we would show how to sum a certain functions called the shifted sums and explain the number theoretic aspect of how to make this shifted sum, and then give an application to counting something on elliptic curves. And now the change would be that we will do still the same thing, but the number theory aspect would be somewhat minimal. Okay, I will just gloss through them and go to the application to the elliptic curve, essentially, because I mean that seems to be the subject which probably would go well with the audience, who are most of you who would like to know what elliptic curves are, in particular in relationship with some ITs and cryptologies, and where they are using all these elliptic curves left and right, and one would like to know why they are there. And how many of them you are sort of studying some cryptology or interested in cryptology type thing in the students? And how many of you have heard something about public key cryptography, and about then how elliptic curves are used for public key cryptography? Okay, that's okay. Therefore, there will be some use of talking about these elliptic curves. Therefore, let us talk with the pure number theory of shifted sums. Yeah, what we are essentially studying in the shifted sums is, I have fn as an arithmetic function, Okay, what is an arithmetic function? I mean, I have a function which is defined on integers. Of course, it may be defined elsewhere also, but it doesn't matter. But it has to be defined definitely on integers, and it may not be extendable to other times. Like, for example, the divisor function. Which is the number of divisors of n, and the number of divisors of n is a number which I can define for every integer n, but outside the integer, of course, I don't define. I mean, I don't see what is called a d of 7.3, the number of divisors of 7.3, etc. I don't define. Therefore, there are functions which can be defined on integers, but it's not clear that they cannot be extended outside the integers. Okay. In this connection, even though this is not something which is relevant to us, but let me point out that you may be having a function which is defined a priori on integers, and it may not look so easy to extend it, but it may still be possible to extend it all the way. Okay. For example, therefore, a priori defined only on integers but extendable. And the very classical example for that is n factorial. N factorial is probably again a number which is defined on integers. I know what 7 factorial means, 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 into 5 into 6 into 7, but there is no obvious meaning which I can give for 4.3 factorial. I mean, say, take all the integers up to 4.3 and multiply and you get etc. Okay. Therefore, this n factorial is a function which is defined on integers, but it's not, it cannot be made sense when n is not an integer. Okay. But on the other hand, Euler pointed out that you can even make sense outside the integers. And you know how he made a sense out of this, for this n factorial outside the integers? Yeah? No. Exactly. What Euler did was to identify this n factorial. Well, if n is an integer, then this n factorial can be identified with the gamma of n plus 1. As most of you would have known, gamma of any number z is equal to 0 to infinity e power minus t t power z minus 1 dt. And then you can write this gamma z, which is e 0 to infinity e power minus t t power z minus 1 dt, and then put z equal to n minus 1 n, and then integrate by parts, then you can find out that gamma n plus 1 equal to n factorial. But as gamma n plus 1, this is a function which is defined for every real number. Okay? Because gamma n plus 1 can be always defined as an integral. Therefore, the gamma n plus 1 is defined as a function of a real number, and therefore, sometimes even functions which are defined only on integers can also be viewed as a function over the whole real numbers. Anyway, but we are interested only in this divisors function. Therefore, I have this function f of n, which is an arithmetic function, but I have another function g of n, which is also an arithmetic function, but I don't have g of n, I have g of n minus 1. And then I want to sum this up all the way from n less than or equal to x, for n equal to 1, 2, 3, etc, etc. Okay. Therefore, I have an f of n and I have a g of n minus 1, and then I want to sum up n not exceeding x, f of n into g n minus 1. Therefore, how will you make this summation? And of course, this in general, one does not have any idea at all, but there are a few things which you can assume about this f and g, and then one can do it. For example, you can assume that this f is a so-called multiplicative function F is a so-called multiplicative function in such a case, and G is also, and therefore if F and G are multiplicative functions, then there is a way of summing of F of n into G of n plus 1, n minus 1 or n plus 1 for that matter, and this number becomes somewhat important. And for example, and this is the starting point of my lecture, essentially how to sum up a functions which look like f of n into g of n minus 1. The question, first question is, why am I interested in this function? Where is this f of n and g of n minus 1, and what is it I am interested in? Okay. Therefore, now let me skip the number theoretic part. Therefore, let me not talk about this f of n, g of n minus 1. Let me talk about why I am interested in that. The reason is that in a certain questions in elliptic curves, such a functions come naturally, and that's exactly the reasons why I really wanted to know what this function is. And therefore, now let's look at this question on the elliptic curve where this function occurs naturally. Therefore, now let me look at this elliptic curve. Yeah, and since most of you said that you have not seen an elliptic curve before, therefore I would probably first of all start saying why such elliptic curves are important in cryptology. I mean, this is some, okay, anyway, first of all, let me just warn you that elliptic curve has nothing in common with the ellipse. Okay, it's completely two different things. There's nothing to do with the ellipse at all. Okay, therefore the question is naturally why one is interested in an elliptic curve. Okay, but okay, the reason is the following. Of course, since some of you are cryptologists and therefore you do the public system cryptography, and that group also I saw only nearly 1/4, and therefore let me even start with saying what is a public system cryptography. Public key cryptography. Then we will say what is this public key cryptography, and then we will see, come back to what is this elliptic curves business. Okay, what is this public key cryptography? You see, first of all, what is a crypto system? Crypto system is that if you have some number A, and this is what you want to send to your friend, then of course you don't send A, but you send B, and then you somehow expect your friend to understand this B which you have written is really the A which you mean. Okay, that's all what cryptography is. And this B is normally done by making some transformation. For example, you may always assume that, okay, therefore since we are anyway going to use these computers for all these purposes, we will assume that our messages are not English statements, but using ASCII or something like that, they have made a number. And therefore, the whole idea of cryptography is essentially you want to send a number 17 to your friend. The 17 is a message. I mean, I am therefore always assuming that messages are number by essentially passing from the English things to ASCII or any things. Okay? But instead of sending 17, you will send 29, and then somehow you want to assure, so you want to make it clear to your friend that when he receives 29, you really mean 17. Okay? Therefore, what is it we have to do? We have to first of all make a transformation, and then you should be also able to tell your friend what the transformation is all about well in before, so that he will always know that. For example, you can agree that whatever you are sending, he should read. If you send X, he should read it as X minus 12. As simple as that. Once you make an agreement, then instead of 17, you send to 29, and then he will read it as 17. Okay. Therefore, you make a transformation on your message. Therefore, you make a transformation on the number and then you inform your friend. Okay? But there's a general principle which says that however complicated your crypto system may be, and if there is an intruder and this intruder is tapped the data, okay, always he would be able to decode the message. The only thing is, if you have not such a complicated system, then he may need 100 megabytes of data. If you make a little more complicated system, he may need 1000 megabytes of data. If you need a much more complicated system, then he may need some 10 lakh bytes of data, things like that. Therefore, it is only the question of that the amount of data that he needs in order to decrypt your system. And you always assume that, of course, your system would be somewhat strong enough that the intruder would not be able to get those much of data. Okay? Now, on the other hand, this is always risky because the intruder also may have some powerful computers and he may be able to do that. And therefore, it's probably not, there should be something more which you should do. Okay? And this idea actually first start with Diffie-Hellman. And then RSA came. And the Diffie-Hellman's idea is to use a public key cryptography such that the keys can be exchanged. And once you exchange the keys, then every day you can exchange the keys, and therefore you can have different keys. And if you have different keys, then the data that he can get is only the data that is going on that particular day. And that data would not be sufficient for him to decrypt the message. Because on the second day, of course, the data would be going on a different key. And the third day, the data would be going on a still different key. Therefore, what is this? Therefore, we look for, okay, therefore now let me give a, let me make it a little more, still little more simpler. Therefore, you have your camp A, this is where you are sitting, and you have the camp B, where this is where your friend is sitting, and you have a message M, and then you encode it, therefore that becomes E, and the E is what you are sending. And then you expect your friend B to read the E that he has received to be M. That's all what the cryptology means. Okay? That you send a message and this guy is, yeah, you are instead of M, you are sending it as E, and you expect your friend to read it. Okay? Now I want to demand something more, and that is what the system cryptology is. That is, the intruder has a spy in camp A and not in camp B. The intruder has a spy in camp A, not in a camp B. Okay. The question actually is it possible to really find out a crypto system like that? That in the camp A, something is encrypted. The intruder even has a spy there. Therefore, he is even seeing how the whole thing is being encrypted. And then you are sending the message. Okay. And the first day. And for the second day, if you use the same key, you expect the intruder not to be able to decode the message. In spite of having a spy there, which is therefore in spite of knowing how the encoding is taking place. Okay? And the first thing you would say, that is impossible. Because if I know how the encoding is taking place, I am going to only decode it. Okay? Decoding is only the reverse process. Whatever is the encoding, decoding is a reverse process. Correct? Therefore, the question, therefore, you would normally say that it is definitely not possible. Then how do you expect that there will be a spy there who will also see your encoding and therefore still the second day he will not be able to decode the message. Now, this can be done. Okay, therefore, what is finally the problem? What is the mathematical problem? Mathematical problem is the spy knows F, but not F inverse. He knows the coding process, which is F, and it's the inverse process is F inverse, the decoding process, and he should know F and he should not know F inverse. Okay? And this is, of course, a practically an impossible question. Okay? There is no way you can make that a person will know F but will not know F inverse. Good? And therefore, this is not the question which we are going to ask. We will going to ask a slightly weaker question. The spy knows F to compute F inverse is time consuming. And that is good enough for me. And computing F inverse is going to be time consuming, it is as good as no saying that he cannot compute F inverse. I am not therefore making a theoretical demand that he should not be able to compute the F inverse. I am only making a practical demand that the computation of the F inverse should take an enormously long time for him. That it would be a useless exercise for him. Is it possible for him to do that? Okay. Therefore, first of all, we should know, have some examples in our ordinary life that once you know F and computing F inverse will be time consuming, and then probably we can try to see that whether those examples in the ordinary life can somehow be made into a crypto system. And in fact, there is a theory which essentially says that if you have any example like that, it can be made into a crypto system. Okay, therefore now let's talk with some examples. At least one example which is easy to understand. But unfortunately, when I want to talk about elliptic curve, that's not the example. I need a bigger example. Okay, this example is an example from integers to integer cross integers to integers. I take two prime numbers P and Q and take the product PQ, that is my F. Okay, therefore F is a function which takes two prime numbers P and Q and takes the product PQ. Okay, and in this example, suppose somebody knows F, which is just a product, yet then F inverse is equivalent to factorization, and therefore taking the product is, as you all know, is very easy. And given a number, factorizing the number is not going to be difficult and it is time consuming. Therefore, on a day-to-day things, we have an example. On a day-to-day thing, we have an example that F is just the multiplication and F inverse is, of course, the factorization. Therefore, if you have your F, for example, is some 1000-bit prime number, then if you are given 2000-bit prime number, of course, I can multiply and I get my F. But on the other hand, that when you multiply the 2000-bit prime numbers, then you will have a 2000-bit number, and then you have to factorize the 2000-bit number. And anybody who has certain experiences in factorizing the numbers would know that factoring a 2000-bit number is not that easy. Okay? And in fact, I don't think we have so far with the advent of computers have factored anything more than 700 and odd bits. 800 bits, etc., we don't even know how to do it. Some special 700 and odd bit numbers, we know how to factorize it. Okay? Therefore, even 800 will not do. And therefore, you know, that means, it is, therefore, I am not even saying that it is theoretically impossible to compute the F inverse. It is practically impossible to compute the F inverse, and that's all what I need. Okay, and therefore you can have a system like that. Okay, and I was saying that the first one was developed by Diffie-Hellman. Okay, which was not based upon that, and in a couple of years later, reversed Shamir and Adleman developed a system. Which is purely based upon that, and that is, since this is not my main interest is whatever Diffie-Hellman did, and therefore I am not going to talk about this. Therefore, what did Diffie-Hellman do? What Diffie-Hellman do is, that's one of the reasons why I did not become so popular at that time itself, essentially because they also produced one such examples where computing F is easy and computing F inverse is difficult, but that example needs a little deeper mathematics compared to what the RSC system, because the RSC system involves the mathematics of multiplication and factorization and nothing more than that, therefore more easy to explain, whereas the Diffie-Hellman etc. involves a mathematics which is a little more deeper. And that mathematics is follows. Let P be a prime number. And therefore now you consider the set elements 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. up to P minus 1. Therefore, you can take addition modulo P and it's a group. This is what you would have seen already. And if you forget the 0, then this is also a group under multiplication modulo P. In fact, this is what one calls as a field in the mathematics, which I won't bother to define. And actually, a little more is true. That this multiplication mod P, not only that this is a thing, this is in fact a cyclic group, which is rather important for us. This is a cyclic group, which means that every element, there is one element called the generator, and then you keep on taking the powers of that generator, then you will get every element of the group. That is all what the cyclic group means, that there is an element called a generator and you can take care of the power, it will cut the generators. And therefore, for example, if you take P equal to 11 and 2 is a generator, because now if you take all the powers of 2, then you have a 1, 2, 2 square, then multiply by 2, you keep on multiply by 2, you get all the elements of the group. Okay, but for P equal to 7 that won't happen, because when you take a 2, you take 2, multiply by 2, you multiply by 2, you get by 1, you don't get all the elements. Okay, this does not mean that it is not a cyclic group. It only means that 2 is not a generator. Probably we should try something else. Maybe 3 is a generator. 3 multiplied by 3, 3 square, 3 cubed, 3 power 4. So there's a 5 which is missing somewhere. Oh. 6 into 3 is 18. 18 is 1 into 3. 3 into 3 is 2. 2 into 3 is 6. 6 into 3 is 18 is 4. 4 into 3 is 5. 5 into 3 is 1. Yeah. Therefore, 3 is a generator. Therefore, every element is a generator. Okay. Now, this is the one which he wanted. Now, let's do what? Now let's do the following. Now take some prime. As an example, let me take the prime 257. And for this prime, one knows that 3 is a generator. Not that easy to check. You should now take 3, 3 square, 3 cubed, 3, 4, 4, keep on multiplying with 3, and then you should check that you get all the elements. But that's not easy, but there are easier methods, let's forget it. 3 is a generator. And now the map, yes. The map F is the following. If I give you an element 42, and then this map takes you to 3 power 42 modulo 257. More generally, it takes any element A to the generator power A modulo the prime B. A goes to G power A modulo P. The 42 goes to 3 power 42 modulo 257. Okay. Now probably some of you might have learned in the algorithms, etc., that essentially by the binary division or the divide and conquer, this F is easy to compute. And what one calls as a polynomial time algorithm. Okay, this is probably a statement, one word which I probably need not define for this audience. Okay, this is a polynomial time algorithms. Therefore, 3 power 42, etc., can also be done in a polynomial time algorithm, essentially by divide and conquer, by powers of 2 vectors. The question is F inverse. Therefore, given this 3 power 42, I have not calculated, let us say 3 power 42 is some 53. Therefore, given this 53, you want to say that this 53 comes from 42. Okay. Therefore, you are given this 53, you should say somewhere 53 comes from 42, which means that you have to solve this equation. 53 is equal to 3 power x modulo 257, and what is this x? Okay, that is your F inverse. Your F inverse question is, I am given a 53 there, and this 53 is comes from x, then what is the x from which this 53 comes? But from this x 53 comes means that 53 is 3 power x modulo 257, and what is this x? Okay, this mod 257 is what kills you. If it were not mod 257, if I ask you what is 53 equal to 3 power x, then what is x, you would have immediately said log 53. To the base 3. Okay, but with the mod 57 you can't do all those things, you know. Therefore, if there were no mod 57, of course you would have answered, oh, this is nothing but x is equal to log 53 to the base 3. But in mod 57 there is no question of log 53 to the base 3, etc. Okay. Therefore, what you are looking at is a logarithm problem, and in this setup we don't know how to solve this logarithm problem. It's exactly as simple as that. Okay, therefore there is a question of just a computation of the algorithm, and we don't know how to do it, and we don't have really a powerful method of computing this algorithm, which means still today the F inverse is rather time consuming, and that is what is this Diffie and Hellman suggested, and a crypto system has been developed based on that, and that is called Algama. And this particular problem is called as a discrete log problem. Okay, this is the logarithm you are looking at, the discrete log problem. Now comes the elliptic curves. Now what happened? So far we have been looking everything in this particular setup, 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. up to p minus 1, of course even forget 0, sorry, modulo p, multiplication modulo p. Therefore, this particular group in mathematics is normally denoted by this symbol. Z over P is Z star. The symbol Z over P is Z star normally stands for the group which is the elements 1, 2, 3, etc. up to P minus 1 with a multiplication modulo P. and that is a cyclic group. Okay. Now, when I say that it's time consuming, that is true, but not too time consuming. That is, by a naive method, trying checking one by one, okay, that is a trial and error. By the naive method, it will take some 100 years. We can reduce the time by half. Therefore, we have powerful methods now which will do it in 50 years. But even then, it is not worth it. But the point is that there are algorithms which are much better than the naive algorithm, reducing the time considerably. That means we would prefer to have an abundance of groups, lots and lots of groups corresponding to each prime P, and in those cyclic groups preferably. And if you have an abundance of cyclic groups for each prime P, then probably I can do the discrete logarithm on those groups. And therefore, if one day, if somebody even finds out a good algorithm to solve this problem for this particular group, that over P is at star, then I will not be in a bad position, because then I can always shift to the other group. Okay. Having only exactly one group is always a tricky affair for your discrete log problem. Because if somebody finds out a good method, because of course people have already found out that one can reduce the time by half or one fourth compared to the Dave algorithm. Of course, which people don't use, because of course instead of saying it I can solve it in 100 years, I can solve it in 25 years, it doesn't still is not worth anything. But somebody may be even able to do it much better, which means I need an abundance of cyclic groups corresponding to each primes, and these ellipticals are the ones which give you the supply of such cyclic groups corresponding to each prime. Therefore, corresponding to each prime, they give you an abundance of cyclic groups, and therefore you can do your discrete log problem there. And what is much more important is that as far as the generality and elliptic group, cyclic group is concerned, nothing for a generic group, nothing better than naive algorithm is known. Nothing better than trial and error is known. Okay. Therefore, even those ideas of at least compared to the naive, I can reduce the time by one fourth or one fifth, even those arguments, we don't have an idea about these elliptic curves. What does that really mean? That really means that if I now go for Z over P Z star, I have to choose a prime number which is at least 600 or 700 bit to have a security. Because the time, as I told you, compared to the naive algorithm, can be reduced by four or five times. Whereas since no such thing is there, if I now use an elliptic curve, a 300 bit prime number, that cyclic group would give you essentially the same security which a 600 bit prime number will give you is an Elgamal, which is essentially the same security which a 2048 bit prime will give you in the original RSA. Okay. Therefore, in the original RSA, whatever security that you are getting from a 2048 primes would always be getting by some 600 bit prime in an Z over P is that discrete log problem, which is the same security which you would get with a 300 bit prime and an elliptic curve. Therefore, let's define what an elliptic curve is. Yeah. This elliptic curve is essentially a curve which looks like that, where a and b are the coefficients, and you are collecting the set of all x, y, which will satisfy this equation. You can draw the graph, whatever curve that is given, you can always draw the graph. You can just choose an x and see the corresponding y and then put that point and keep on doing that, okay? And for some technical reasons, people will put a condition that 4a cubed plus 27b square is different from 0, but we won't bother about that. Okay, therefore, now this is what an elliptic curve is. And what does it do? Now when we take this elliptic curve, okay, the thing is, the elliptic curves are interesting to study. Over complex numbers, which means to set, take a complex number x, compute the corresponding complex number y, drop, put that point, and take another complex number y, and then draw the graph. Or over rational numbers, or over finite fields with the p elements. Finite fields with the p elements is precisely what I told you, 0, 1, 2, 3, etc., p minus 1, and which is a group under addition and a group under multiplication, and that gives you a finite field. This is where it is interesting to study, and less interesting over R. But unfortunately, if I want to draw a graph of a curve, it is much easier to draw only over R. I don't even know how to draw a curve over C or over ZP or Q. Therefore, all the time I will be, when I will say that, when I draw the graph, I will be drawing over real numbers, okay? But I will always have something other than real numbers in mind. Real number, the elliptic curves over real numbers is not such an interesting subject, okay? And therefore, in elliptic curve, will look like that. Okay, this is how an elliptic curve will look like. And what is interesting is that the points of these elliptic curves form a group. That's a theorem. The points of this elliptic curve form a group. Okay, and in fact, what is the group? And the group under addition. I mean, when I say a group, okay, a group, something is a group under certain binary operation. And whether I want to call that binary operation or as a multiplication or as an addition is, of course, my choice. Therefore, there is nothing special about that addition there. I just decide to call the binary operation as addition, and therefore instead of taking the element g1 and g2 and saying g1 dot g2, I will only say g1 plus g2, nothing more than that. Okay, and therefore the 0 will be the identity element, and the binary operation will be given by plus, and nothing more than that. But it is, of course, if I don't like plus, I want to write g1 into g2, etc., I can always write g1 into g2. The group is not going to change anyway. And the binary operation is also somewhat easy to explain. It's not difficult. The point is that the binary operation is given by, you take any two points, take the straight line and join in them, and take the reflection on the x-axis. Therefore, I take a point P and Q, take the straight line and joining them, and it meets the curve at the third point R, and I take the reflection, and the reflection is called S, and I just define my P plus Q equal to S. That's all. That's a binary operation. My binary operation is that I take two points and take the straight line joining them, take the reflection, and therefore it is not that obvious or easy to see that it in fact forms a group under such a contrived law. Okay? And of course, if I take two points, of course I take the chord. But if I don't take two points, if I take one single point and I want to add to itself instead of the chord, I will take the tangent. If there are two points and if you have a chord and these two points come to one single point, then it will be just the tangent which you have to take at that point. Okay? Fine? Okay. This is the group, and this, the funny part is that this is a group. Okay, and therefore now I can explicitly write. Therefore, suppose you are given x1, y1, and if you are given x2, y2, and then if you want to write the S, then it's not difficult at all. You take the straight line in joining x1 into x2, y2, and see where it meets the curve. you always know that when two curves meet and then you want to know the point of intersection, you have to simply solve the two equations. Then when you can solve the equations of this straight line with this curve, and then it will give you the point of intersection. And then reflection. Reflection is always, if you have a point x, y, of course the reflection is x minus y. And that's all what you are going to get. Therefore, you can explicitly write this formula. This tells you that if you want to add x1, y1 and x2, y2, then this is equal to, take the straight line joining x1, y1 and x2, y2, write that straight line as y equal to mx plus c. Take the straight line joining x1, y1 and x2, y2, take the straight line y equal to mx plus c and see where it meets, and then see, take the point of intersection, take the inversion, and that is going to give you and that is going to be my x3, and my y3 is going to be my x3 is going to be m square minus x1 minus x2, and my y3 is going to be minus of mx3 plus c, which comes essentially from the geometrical thing which I said, and therefore it's not difficult. But on the other hand, if I told you to start with that I am going to define an addition of x1 y1 and x2 y2 by this method, that x1 y1 plus x2 y2 equal to m square minus x1 minus x2 comma minus of mx3 plus c, and that is going to be a group you will not even believe to be, okay? And you would be wondering why this contrived law makes it is a group, but it is a group, okay? And on the other hand, if you want to add the points x, y to itself, again, of course, you have to do, take the tangent y equal to mx plus c at that point. And do the same thing. If it is two different points, of course, take the chord joining the two points. If it's one single point to add itself, of course, take the tangent at that point, and that's all. Okay? And the inverse of xy is the reflection. Now, of course, whenever there is a group, of course, I have to tell you what is identity, okay? And only funny problem is that this, I am now, when I draw all these graphs, etc., I am not able to see the identity, and therefore, I will assume that identity is somewhere there which I am not able to see. Therefore, this group has an identity, infinity comma infinity. Okay, therefore, there is some point infinity comma infinity sitting on that curve, and that point infinity comma infinity sitting on the curve will serve as an identity of this group. Okay. Good. Now something interesting is happening. What is happening is, I have some 10 more minutes or. Yeah. Now something interesting is happening. What is happening is, now suppose over FP I consider this curve. Over this finite field I consider this curve. The same curve. Therefore I decide to take a curve y square equal to x cube plus ax plus b over FP. FP of course is a finite field, and the finite field of course I have given 0, 1, b minus 1, and that finite field I take that. Okay? And therefore, obviously, as I said, I have no way of drawing a graph or anything like that over the finite field. Of course, there are only finitely many points. If p equal to 11, there will be 11 points on the x coordinate, and there will be exactly 11 points on the y coordinate. And therefore, totally some 121 points will be there in my plane. And in 121 points, I can't draw a graph. But suppose I decide to define a group law by this formula. Suppose I decide to define a group law by the same formula, then that forms a group. Over FP, therefore that is form a group. Therefore, of course, I wrote the group formula by first a geometric things of a tangent and chord process, taking the chord and joining the two points, I take the reflection. Then I wrote the formula explicitly. X1 plus X2 Y2 equal to M square minus X1 minus X2 comma minus of MX with 3 plus C, where Y equal to MX plus C is the record joining them. And then I say that not over the real line, whatever field I think, I take over that field and I use the same formula, and that gives you a group. Now you see what happened. Therefore, given a prime P, I can now take my FP, I can take any elliptic curve I want, y square equal to x cube plus ax plus b, and then I have a group now, which is all what I wanted to do. For every p, then I wanted to have an abundant number of groups, which would give you this. Okay? Therefore, for every p, I have a group, coming from this elliptic curve. And now something a little more, namely, this A and B there in that equation is not God given. I can change them. I can change A to be any element of FP. I can choose B to be any element of FP. And therefore, there are actually P square choices for my A and B. Of course, all the P square choices are not allowed because I initially put some condition like 4A cubed plus 27B square is not equal to 0, and that would kill a few of them. But still I will have p square choices. Therefore, there are essentially around p square such elliptic curves, and therefore p square such different groups. Therefore, corresponding to p, now not only I have produced one extra group now, earlier I had only one group to the whole thing, z over p z. But now corresponding to this elliptic curve, I have produced p square such new groups. Okay? And now what do I know about these groups? Okay, there's a theorem of Hasse and Weil, which is what I want. If E is an elliptic curve over FP, then there's a group, of course. All the points form a group. And the question is, how many elements, this is a finite group, obviously, this is a finite group obviously because what do you mean by a curve? Given A and B by a curve, I mean I choose any x in the field, compute x cube plus ax plus b, see whether that is a square in that field. If it is a square, I take the square root. And I put this as y. Good. But x itself has only p choices because my field itself has only p choices, and y has at most p choices, therefore totally p square choices. Therefore, this is only a finite field. But what they proved, that this is a finite group and the number of elements this is where the number theory comes. Because I started with, as I say, that what we do in number theory is count something. And this is what I want to count. I take the elliptic curve and count how many points are there. Okay? And most of the time, I may not be able to do it exactly. Here and there, some error would be there. And I am ready to adjust to the error. This number of elements, including the identity, because I have to be slightly careful there, because I don't see this identity in my curve at all. Since I don't see an identity of this group in the curve at all, I have just said that there is some point at infinity, which is an identity, is p plus 1. That is the number of elements of this curve. With an error, at most 2 times square root of p. Therefore, the number of points of this elliptic curve is really p plus 1 with an error, which is 2 times square root of p. Therefore, now ignoring the error, therefore I have an elliptic curve. Therefore, given such a curve, given such a prime P, then I have essentially P square such groups, and the order of those P square groups are essentially P plus 1. The earlier I had only one group whose order is P. Now these groups have an order P plus 1. Okay? And now the next theorem, which is almost important, most of them have a cyclic subgroup. Of order bigger than or equal to P plus 1 by 4. Therefore, they have a big cyclic subgroup. Therefore, they have a big cyclic subgroup. Therefore, I can use my discrete logarithm in that big cyclic subgroup. I just need a cyclic subgroup to do my discrete logarithm. And therefore, I have now P square such groups where I can do my discrete logarithm. And for these groups, that is better than name method is known, and therefore if I now develop a crypto system based upon the hardness of the discrete log problem on these elliptic curves, then even with some 300-350 bit prime, I acquire the same security which we will be able to do. Therefore, the next question is how to develop such a crypto system, and that would take one more extra lecture which I don't have time to, and I will stop here. Yes, sir.
I have a couple of questions. So, here, what has a, in a finite group, how can you define the identity as infinity?
In a finite group, how can I define an identity as infinity, infinity? Okay, you have this curve. Okay, suppose I put x equal to infinity. Then y becomes infinity because I have y square equal to x cube plus ax plus b, and therefore there is a point infinity, infinity sitting somewhere, and that happens to be the identity.
But how does that belong to the finite sub or the finite group itself? Do you define that as belonging to the?
Oh, okay, you just take it as belonging to FP, exactly. That's no other way. Okay. Wait. Yeah, you just take it as belonging to FP because there's no other way. Because that is the identity, and if you want a group, you have to have an identity. And therefore, if the identity does not belong to the group, you to the field, you better put that in the field. There's nothing else you can do.
And the cyclic subgroups of order P plus 1 greater than P plus 1 over 4, Do we know the generators for those cyclic subgroups, or finding them is hard to
do? The finding them is... Finding them is what should I say? It's okay. I don't think finding them is somewhat, I don't think it's easy, but you can sort of. I mean, given a cyclic group, okay, finding out a generator, provided you know the order of the group, is not very difficult. You see, that's a general theorem. That's a general theorem. Suppose G is a cyclic group of order N, and suppose you pick a point A in the group G, and suppose you know that A power N equal to 1, of course it has to be because by Lagrange's theorem, but if A has not lower order, which means that suppose you know that A power N over P is not equal to 1 for any prime divisor of N, then that is good enough for you to conclude that A is in fact the generator. Okay. And therefore, if you know the N, and once you know the N, then you have a, you, suppose you know the prime factors, you take the A, take the A power N by P, etc., etc. And the second result is that for a cyclic group of order N, then the number of generators is exactly phi n. Okay? And phi n is the so-called Euler phi function, and it is known that phi n is bigger than n over log n. which means that if you pick an arbitrary element, then with a probability which is bigger than 1 over log n, then you hit upon the generator, which essentially means that picking up a generator is a polynomial time algorithm, but not a deterministic polynomial time algorithm, but a randomized polynomial time algorithm. Yes, subject to the condition that you are ready to allow certain randomized polynomial time algorithm, then you can always pick up the generator. But even in general case, even for ZP, okay, we still do not know any, for the special group ZP, we still do not know any deterministic polynomial time algorithm to pick up the generator. We still have only a randomized polynomial time algorithm.
that would
exceed my time, and that will just concentrate more on the elliptical rather than the number theoretic way I am doing that. Yes, I mean the reason, number theoretic reason for considering that was that it has something to elliptic curve, and if I have to even give the connection of that to the elliptic curve, that already would take a little longer time. But essentially, I want to see how many elliptic curves defined over Q are there. When you reduce modulo p, will have the number of the group order will be exactly equal to n, and when you do that calculation, then these numbers do come.
Define some other curves just like elliptic curves and develop the same kind of theory. What is it especially for these?
Okay, it's not clear, but so far all the attempts have failed, and therefore probably the elliptic curves is the only one. You see, because because first of all you need the group structure, okay, and therefore now to have a curve which itself serves as the group also, okay, that's only the elliptic curve. But then you can ask, why should I have the curve itself should serve as the group? I have the curve, and the curve gives a group, and that group is good enough for me, okay. And such a theory is there, and that is called the Jacobian. Therefore, given a curve, you can define the Jacobian of the curve, and the Jacobian of the curve is a group, and etc., etc. And in that particular way, you can define this elliptic curve into a more general things called abelian varieties of higher genus. And some works have gone in that. And then, because they give you they are the Jacobians. And the other way to do it is, instead of taking y square equal to a cubic polynomial, you can take y square to a higher degree polynomial. That gives you a curve, y square equal to a fifth degree polynomial, that will give you a curve. Such curves are called hyperelliptic curves, but they don't inherit the group structure. But for such an hyperelliptic curves, you can of course define the Jacobian, and that will inherit the group structure. And it is not clear from the security point of view whether the hyperelliptic curves are better than or worse than the elliptic curves. And in fact, I should probably say, okay, that the research in this area, I mean, tremendously going, but tremendously was going till, I should say, 2012, 2013, when there were a lot of conferences, a lot of papers. But now people seem to think that as the quantum computers, people are claiming if such a quantum computer comes in 10 years, probably this may become obsolete. Is it worth it now spending the time, and so on and so forth. Therefore, now the research in this particular area somehow seems to be connected with when the quantum computer is coming, and in that particular case, whether these calculations of this hardness of these problems would still continue to be relevant, whether it is worth spending the time and money. I mean, therefore, now there is a little confusion in this area. But as far as I could see, the people have been saying quantum computer is coming in within the next 10 years from 1990 onwards. And therefore, I don't see why in 2015 it should suddenly become a reality.
Thanks a lot, Professor. We have a lunch period right now, and we can resume the talk session post lunch at 2 o'clock. Thank you.